Morning, everybody. My name is Michael Kearney, and I'm here to talk about cybercrime. According to the Boston Standard out of the United Kingdom, cybercrime is a big business for fraudsters. Last year, fraudsters racked up over $1 billion just in the UK alone, causing damages to security systems, people's bank accounts, and the people's families. I want you to try to imagine this $1 billion. Think about the implications it has just leaving an economy in general. $1 billion is a big deal. But what could be done about it? What can we do to prevent that from happening? Technology is not slowing down, it's speeding up. And the people who are trying to hurt you and take your money and take what belongs to you are moving just as fast with it, if not faster. I want you to take your laptop, the one that I'm sure you've all been on today. If you haven't been on it yet, you will be. I want you to think of all the credit card information, all of the data, all of your maybe social security information and passwords. And I want you to imagine walking into Starbucks, sitting down at that Starbucks, seeing all the people around you, maybe the guy just drinking a coffee next to you on his laptop. If you enter their Wi-Fi, this man can now be into your computer. Starbucks doesn't spend the money to protect their systems. So this man's now on your computer, he has access to all of your information. Everything on your computer. If you buy something right next to him, he knows what number you use. He can destroy your life. He can take everything from you. And there's nothing you can do about it. Before I get into this, I want to talk about the background of cybercrime. In 1997, cybercrime was small, virtually irrelevant. Thieves and hackers didn't really have much to go on. They started off small, and they pretty much stayed small for the time being. You fast forward 16 years, it's a huge jump in technology. It basically left the US defenseless. There's nothing they can do to protect themselves because they've advanced the technology so far, but they haven't been able to advance the security systems far enough quite yet. The hackers are always one step ahead. George Stewart of the George Washington International Law Review stated that the global cost of cybercrime is $375 billion. It's a lot of money globally. That can fix a lot of problems on this world. Now the question is, what do? Do we fight? Do we stand up for it? Do we get our government to do it? Well, what do? We can't become hackers. That's an acquired trait. It's a harder than people think it is. Cybercrime is a dangerous and seemingly unending threat to our world, which is why I'm here. I'm going to explain to you the dangers and the causes and how much it's costing us of cybercrime. First, I'm going to talk about what is cybercrime, how much it costs, and everything that has to go with basically just a general idea of cybercrime. I'm going to follow that by the multiple ways that it can affect you and your children. And finally, we'll venture into how can we defend ourselves from cybercrime, not only personally, how can our nations defend ourselves? I'm excited to jump in, so bear with me, because I really like talking about this. What is cybercrime? How much does it cost? To begin, I'm going to go to findlaw.com. They state, cybercrimes are offenses committed via the internet or otherwise various forms of technology. That seems very broad. Seems like you have a lot, there's a lot to work with there. Well, in addition to that, it's just the tip of the iceberg. There's so much we don't know about. Bill Liberis of scienceintelligence.com stated that as of 12 years ago, or as of 2012, $80 billion was spent on cyber crimes worldwide on just defending these networks. Worldwide, criminals make up to $500 billion. Sounds like a lot of money. These are numbers that are the global practice of 2012. Not today, these are 2012 numbers. As you can see, it was only $113 billion is what the entire net worth was. $298 per person. Now that seems like the numbers might seem a little jumbled, but it's $80 million was just towards protecting them. That was $123 million in total, or $123 billion apologize, in total. Next is, what are the multiple ways that we can protect us, that they can attack us, and that they can attack our children? There are many forms of it. Identity theft, different types of rings, dark webs, child abduction sites. There's many different ways. But one of the most important ways is identity theft. Nick Bontes of Cyber Crimes, Made It Easy, is the name of the article, said 1 million people in Canada will suffer identity theft, $6 billion in money loss from those 1 million people. 50% of that money will be unauthorized credit cards. 20% of those victims will be the victim to somebody they know. The crime will be committed by somebody they know. That's 14 months on average for them to realize that something's wrong before they even get into what could have happened. Next, one of the other important ones is kind of a touchy subject, but I kind of like the touchy subject. Online child abuse is repulsive, it's pathetic, and it's immoral, but it's fairly new. And pedophiles worldwide have joined in this disgusting act to try to make a quick buck. ABC News said in 2015 that a group called Children E-Safety Commissioner's Office had 7,400 cases. 92% of those cases said that the child was female and under 12 years old. That sounds awful, and it's probably hard to swallow to some people. But out of the 7,400 cases, they would have shut down thousands of URLs, almost essentially shutting down every single website that was showing off all those pictures. Well, that's what's how we protect ourselves, and how do we protect our nation? First, let's look at the defense of our own lives. We can't do much. We're not hackers. There's not much we know. USNorth.com said, you must keep your current software up to date, use strong passwords, and be vigilant. The nation must also defend itself. Seekers that threaten national security, according to FBI.com, they're focusing on two priorities: computer and network intrusion and ransomware. Using now explosive technology, investigative capabilities, and partnerships, they hunt the national, global hackers that are trying to take everything over. The National Cyber Forensics and Training Alliance was started in 1997. Before the FBI, they were the only model for bringing the agencies together, so the FBI likes to use them. Now, this seems like a lot of info. Today, I shared what cybercrime is, how much it costs, multiple ways cybercrime affects you and your children, and finally, I talked about how we can defend ourselves as a nation and individually. Informed well, we can work on the advancements and the technology we need to get working on protecting our future. I encourage you to visit FBI.gov. It's a website that has an entire section on these crimes that people are committing. I want to leave you with one quote. It's just, you know, something that makes a lot of sense in this situation. James Scott, the Institute for Clinical Infrastructure Technology, said, the next president is going to inherit the most sophisticated and persistent cyber espionage of any culture the world has ever seen. He needs to surround himself with experts, and he can expedite an allocation of potent layers of next-generation defenses around our targeted and critical infrastructure silos.